Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Welcome to today's lecture. We will start from equation 9.41, the book by Ali Umar, at page 437. We were discussing paramagnetism and we finished with the quantum theory of paramagnetism, but with the case J is equal to half. Now, if J is larger than half, then in general the number of levels would be 2J plus 1, which leads to the susceptibility given by this equation. Equation 9.41 was derived for the case in which X is much less than 1. Which means that X is approximately, tangent hyperbolic X is approximately equal to X. And this is how we get equation 9.41. But this equation is for the case J is equal to half. But for J larger than half, then the susceptibility is given by 9.42. Here, the term used, mu effective, is equal to P into the Bohr magneton, and mu effective is equal to P into Bohr magneton, and P is given by G, G factor, and bracket J into J plus 1 power half. The number P is called the effective number of Bohr magnetons for the atom. We shall consider the derivation of this equation in the problem section. We can see, therefore, that quantum mechanical treatment leads to the same conclusion as the classical treatment. Okay, the next topic is the atomic origin of magnetism. In this section, we will study when there are large number of atoms making a solids and how the magnetism of the electrons and the magnetism of each atom is coupled with the orbital magnetism and the spin magnetism. We can explain the atomic origin of magnetism by considering orbital and spin motions and the interaction between them. The total orbital angular momentum of the atom is given by this, where the sum is over all electrons. So Li shows the orbital angular momentum, magnetic momentum for the ith electron. Since the sum over a complete shell is zero, however, we must carry out the summation only over the incomplete shells. Similarly, the total spin angular momentum is given by capital S is equal to summation over Si, where again the sum is over the incomplete shells. So we will add these vectors L and S over the incomplete shells, because the complete shells offer zero values of capital L and capital S. The total angular momentum of the atom J is given by J is equal to L plus S. Now this is the vector sum. So equation 9.44 gives us the total angular momentum of the atom J. Okay, the angular momenta L and S interact with each other via the spin orbit interaction. So this term spin orbit interaction is very important here, because this will give us how these spin magnetism and the orbital magnetism is coupled. The interaction exists above and beyond the Coulomb interaction between the electrons and the nucleus, and the interaction between the electrons themselves. P Because of this interaction, the vectors L and S are no longer constants. So that is the important result, that the vectors L and S are not constants individually, but their vectors L and S will remain constant. However, L and S will interact with each other and will keep on decreasing or increasing with reference to this figure shown here, the figure 9.1, the spin orbit interaction including derivation of the Landé factor. Okay, so however, the total angular momentum J remains constant, thus the vectors L and S precess around J as indicated in figure 9.10. So the statement given here that L and S are not individually constants, but the total angular momentum J will remain constant, this leads to the precessional motion of the vectors L and S, and whereas J remains at the same position. So L and S will have a precessional motion around J. The dipole moment mu L is equal to minus E over 2m into L, and mu S is equal to minus E over m into S, corresponding to the orbital and spin momenta. Also, they also precess around J, and this precessional motion is shown here in the bottom part of this figure. The top part is regards with the momentum capital L and S, and the mu S and mu L have the same story but in the opposite direction because of this negative sign shown here. However, note that the total momenta mu, which is equal to the vector sum of mu L and mu S, is not collinear with J. So you also note that they are not collinear, the vectors capital J and the vector capital mu, they are not collinear. Okay, as in the pure moments mu L and mu S, but in is tilted towards the spin because of its larger gyromagnetic ratio. The vector mu makes an angle theta with J, and this moment also precesses around J. Since the precession frequency is usually quite high, only the component of mu along J is observed. Okay, the other component averages out to be zero, so one can show that mu average is given by this equation. So here is mu, the total momentum, and here is the mu average. So because of the high precessional frequency, the component of mu along the line of J will contribute, whereas the other component will average out to be zero. So we will have this component mu average is equal to mu cos theta is equal to G into minus E over 2m into J, where G is given by this expression. Now this is again, this derivation can be seen from any book on atomic physics. We are getting this result from atomic physics. This is the G factor which we have used previously for a pure orbital motion. Small s is equal to zero, small j is equal to L, and G is equal to m. While for a pure spin motion, L is equal to zero, J is equal to S, and G is equal to 2. These values agree with the discussion in section 9.2. However, note now that mu we have we used earlier in this section is equal to mu average, where the subscript was dropped. Now, how J and L are coupled is given by Hund's rule, and the Hund's rule is stated here. How may we determine L, J and S for an atom if all we know is the number of electrons in the incomplete shell and the angular momenta of this shell? We do this by the following Hund's rules. The first rule is that the spin number S takes its maximum value allowed by the Exclusion principle. Then L also takes its maximum value allowed by the same principle, consistent with 1. If the shell is less than half full, then J is equal to absolute value of L minus S, and if the shell is more than half full, the value of J is equal to L plus S. So let us apply these rules to the carbon atom. So what is being stated here is that if you know the number of electrons in an atom and you know the individual values of G, small g and small l for each electron, then how you will add up the values of J and L to get the total value of the atom. Because of this orbit spin interaction, this is not very simple. So Hund's rule states how we will get the total value of small j and the value of small l for an atom. Okay, so let us apply these rules to the carbon atom. Now, there are only 2 electrons in the 2p shell, so L is equal to 1, which can accommodate a maximum of 6 electrons. To determine the angular momentum, we can make the 2 spin parallel to each other without violating the Exclusion principle, resulting in S is equal to 2 into S, which is equal to 2 into half is equal to 1. So the maximum L consistent with the Exclusion principle is L is equal to Y. You can think over it. Since the shell is less than half full, so the total value of J will be given by the absolute value of L minus S, which comes out to be 0. So thus, in the ground state, the carbon atom has 0 magnetic moment and exhibits no paramagnetism. In most cases involving incomplete shells, however, J is other than 0 and the atom then shows paramagnetism. Okay, so let us discuss 2 special cases. One is the rare earth ions. Experiments on rare earth ions in crystals show that they obey the Curie law, which we have derived earlier. With an effective number of magnetons in agreement with the theory of spin orbit interaction, table 9.3 confirms this. In these ions, therefore, the angular momenta L and S are strongly coupled, and the moment of the ion can respond freely to the external field. Okay, so you can look at this table and see in various rare earth ions what is the situation in the ground state and what is the value of small p and what is the value of p. Experimental value, this is theoretical value, and when we see that the theoretical value is 0, it means the substance is diamagnetic, and when this value is not 0, then the substance is paramagnetic. And you can see that the value obtained from the theoretical result above and the experimental value of P, they are quite matching. So this result is not surprising. In these ions from lanthanum to lutetium in the periodic table, the 4F shell is incompletely filled. The outer 5P shell is completely filled. while the 5D and 6S shells, which are still further out, are stripped of their electrons to form the ionic crystal. Thus, the only incomplete shell is the 4F shell, and this is the one in which the magnetic behavior occurs. Since electrons in this shell lie deep within the ion, screened by the outer 5P and the 5D shells, they are not appreciably affected by other ions in the crystal. So magnetically, their behavior is much like that of a free ion. So typical values for the spin orbit and the crystal field interactions in these materials are 10 to the power 3 per centimeter and 10 to the power 2 per centimeter respectively. Okay, the other example is that of the iron group ions. Now table 9.4 shows that iron group ferric or ferrous ions behave magnetically as if J is of the value of S. That is, only the spin moment can contribute to the magnetization. We can see this by means of the following argument. The magnetic properties of this group of elements are due to the electrons in the incomplete 3D shells. Since electrons in this outermost shell interact strongly with neighboring ions, the orbital motion is essentially destroyed by quenched, leaving only the spin moment to contribute to the magnetization. In other words, in these ions, the strength of the crystal field is much greater than the strength of the spin orbit interaction, just the reverse of the situation in rare earth ions. Typical strengths of the crystal field and spin orbit interactions in the iron group are 10 to the power 4 per centimeter and 10 to the power 2 per centimeter respectively. Okay, now what next? Okay, so spin, let us talk about the spin magnetism. Spin paramagnetism arises from the fact that each conduction electron carries a spin magnetic moment which tends to align with the field. In calculating the susceptibility, one may be inclined to the result of equation 9.41 with J is equal to S is equal to half, which gives chi is equal to this, where we have also set G is equal to 2. Since we are dealing with a pure spin motion, this shows that chi is inversely proportional to temperature. Experiments show, however, that spin susceptibility in metals are essentially independent of temperature. But this is a contradiction. The observed values are also considerably smaller than the predicted by equation 9.46. So we have both the contradiction in the magnitude of the value and in the and the temperature dependence. These facts clearly cast strong doubts on the applicability of equation 9.41 to the conduction electrons. The source of the difficulty lies in the fact that equation 9.41 was derived on the basis of localized electrons obeying the Boltzmann distribution. The conduction electrons, on the other hand, are delocalized and satisfy the Fermi-Dirac distribution function. So here is the justification of this contradiction between the experimental and the observed value. The proper treatment taking this into account is illustrated in figure 9.12. This is the figure 9.12. The case A is when B is equal to 0. The two halves of the Fermi-Dirac distributions are equal, and thus total magnetization is zero. Whereas in figure B, when a field B is applied, spins in the anti-parallel half flips into the parallel half, resulting in a net parallel magnetism. So because of this flipping, we have the net magnetism not equal to zero. And you can go through the rest of this page, this paragraph and page, to understand the spin magnetism and the diamagnetism as given here. Okay, in our next lecture, we will discuss ferromagnetism, and that will be the last lecture of the midterm, and you will have examination after that. Midterm examination of after that, or whatever is decided by the university, we will follow that. So next, tomorrow's lecture will be based on ferromagnetism in insulators. Okay, you can go through the relevant pages of the Kittel on this topic, and these are the relevant pages: paramagnetic susceptibility of conduction electrons at page 315, the book by Kittel. Okay, so this book is also with you, and the same thing is discussed here, but with a quantitative description. Okay, but essentially you will prepare this lecture from Ali Umar. Okay, thank you very much.